Hello, ladies and gents. Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. It's time for some Quake.
Yes, sir. We have got a lot of games coming up today, and a lot of different game modes as well, and a lot of different maps and players. TDM, CTF, and Duel. Every single series. Well, unless some teams get stomped and we'll only see TDM and CTF, but I think that's what people want to say after we had a full day of Duel yesterday.
Yeah, so four teams. Mm-hmm. It's basically like a playoff bracket. So we have two semifinals and the grand finals. So, and we have like the... It's kind of weird to explain it because it's... Three best is a best of three,
yep.
Which has within it
within a best of three,
best of three,
three game modes
exactly. So TDM, CTF, yeah. Duel.
It's pretty intense. Can we bring up the teams as well? We can have a look at the kind of players we're going to be seeing today. You would have seen a bunch of them yesterday. You can see on Meltdown there was Tox. He was in the semi-finals yesterday. He unfortunately lost to Evil very narrowly in one of the closest series of the day. He is alongside winz, Linkin, and Zyrinx. Linkin, winz, and Zyrinx, they were teamed up with Gerpa last year as they were playing CTF under, I think, the unknown tag, and unfortunately weren't able to get the results that they wanted. But Tox is in the team now, and I know that Linkin, winz, and Zyrinx are also extremely adamant in proving themselves this year. I don't think they had enough practice last year. They're going to show us what they're made of today and at QuakeCon. iGamers... We saw the champion yesterday, Cypher, taking down Evil in a very convincing 3-0. Clawz wasn't able to make top four. These guys are alongside Strengths and Silencep. This is the team, DDK, that I'm quite nervous about watching today.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how prepared they are as a team.
It's really hard to say, isn't it? It's very hard. Because, for example, with Meltdown, those four players, their abilities in CTF... And TDM, on paper, is probably the best out of every team here.
Yeah,
I think
it's
very, very fair to say. The only thing that they could maybe fall down on is Duel, that you have Toxic, you...
Yeah.
so it's a really, really sick team.
Fortunately, though, for iGamers, they don't have to go versus Meltdown first. iGamers will go versus Averages. So, but if iGamers can somehow get their way onto Duel, then they're good. But yeah. I don't even know yet if they're going to be able to do that, as I know that Meltdown guys and Averages are practicing so hard, I feel like they're a step ahead of them. Deliberate Murder for me is a bit unknown. You can see Cooler is playing with Strengths. That's Latrommi, guys, I promise. There's a picture of Latrommi as well. and this is Pavel and Fortune. Strengths isn't on two teams, guys, pinky promise. But yeah, these guys are like TDM legends, essentially, in the Quake live scene. They won the Prague TDM Cup, which was a long time ago now.
Yeah.
And having them going against Meltdown in TDM right off the bat is actually one of the biggest matchups of the day. I'm really not sure who's going to go ahead in that.
Yeah.
But on the far right, you can see Averages, which will go against iGamers. They had three of their duelers in yesterday, none of which made it to the playoffs. Fazz, Sparty, and Noctis are who we saw dueling. They're alongside Demon, the Master of Choke.
Damn!
But Demon is definitely more of a team player, I'd say, than a dueler.
Yeah.
Even though we see him duel all the time,
he's
all about the team games.
I think a lot of Quakers duel out of necessity, especially a lot of the top team players, because you know, you get more games, more tournaments to play, so it's always nice to mix it in. But yeah, I think with the Deliberate Murder squad, they're... I think the problem for them is that, as we mentioned, they're against Meltdown first. So that's really tough because Meltdown are definitely by far the favourites because they're so strong at TDM, so strong at CTF, and also Duel as well. And of course, if they're able to get to, you know, get Cooler into a Duel, then hey, they've got good chances to actually close out a best of three.
But imagine if they got to the Duel section. That's a Cooler versus Tox at the end. We didn't get to see that. Yesterday.
Oh, it's a really old school classic as well.
That would be pretty hype, I think. And to be honest, out of the two semifinals, I think that's the one most likely to get to the Duel. Because I feel like Deliberate Murder, they still kind of have the momentum, if you want, in the community with the Duel spirit and the kind of... They're very much purebred. They don't really take a break. The one thing that Cooler takes a break from in Quake Live now, every so often, is Duel. But he's usually really active with his teammates in Deliberate Murder. But the Meltdown guys...
Yeah, how do they beat them? And because TDM is the best shot, basically. Mm-hmm. If they don't win the TDM, you don't really like the chances to get to the Duel.
Yeah.
But the thing is that Deliberate Murder, as you mentioned, they've got quite a storied history when it comes to TDM.
Yeah.
Last time I played TDM, I lost against them in Euro Cup finals. But
sorry,
they played dirty, man. They played dirty. So
wow.
Still salty about that.
It's in the air here. Oh man.
But I mean, the thing is that they could very well, depending on the map, and that's really the thing. All the maps, it could very well happen for them. Well, so I'm quite curious.
We've got the maps for the first series on TDM. So between Deliberate Murder and Meltdown, we are going to have Ragnarok, the new TDM map that is picked by Meltdown.
Yeah, that's really cool to see.
We've got Dreadful Place, which is picked by Deliberate Murder, and it's their home map. I think everyone would expect them to pick that. And then I think the tiebreaker is going to be Purgatory between them. So I can see that it's like best of three getting to the end tiebreaker of the first best of three. Don't know yet about the second one. We have no idea what's happening on the CTF yet. But I can actually see Dreadful Place going over to Deliberate Murder, Ragnarok going to Meltdown, and getting a tiebreaker there.
It's their best chance for sure. I think Dreadful Place was always a map where they were just incredibly good because they're just always so amazing at just hitting all the item timings and being moving as a unit, which is just picking everything up basically. They're just denying everything from you. But that said, the brute force of Meltdown is so sick. It's like Toxic, Winz, Zyrinx, and Linkin. You've got like the four best TDM aim stars almost in the same team.
I've been talking to Demon, and he's been practicing with Meltdown a lot, and he's like, these guys are pretty scary at the moment. They've been playing against them enough that they're having some close matches now, but Meltdown still seem to be maybe a step above others. However, I'm actually kind of uncertain about Deliberate Murder in terms of their practice regime or anything like that. I have no idea what to expect from Deliberate Murder, but they are masters. Let's get into the TDM though. We are starting on Ragnarok right now between Deliberate Murder and Meltdown. We are on Winz straight off the beginning. We are blessed with some insane players today. I'm so glad we got to see some team games here at the FACEIT Road2Quakecon. And Winz is going to be able to get his first frag. Going to die very shortly after as we check out Latrommi. Latrommi, you won't really see him in duel, but he is one of the most praised TDM players in the world, actually, at the moment. This Fierce, who's not going to be going to Quakecon, which is definitely a name you have to mention, but Latrommi is a massive star. Definitely a guy that the Deliberate Murder artists
are. Oh my god.
a guy that the Deliberate Murder players are very happy to be playing with. We have got a Cooler right here. He's got the quad damage. Let's see if he can do anything. He seems to have no items, no weapons. Maybe he can change that.
Yeah, the quad damage is so far going to be brought into the red armor room. Is he going to be able to take it away from the battle suit? He's not going to be able to do so just yet. It was a good attempt, but he just did not have the resources really to stay alive long enough. And Winz is going to be just getting some control on the map. He's got, of course, that battle suit going for him. So that's going to be protection also, not just against splash damage and environmental effects, but also it helps you again, just general damage reduction. So very good stuff here from Winz. Able to clear out this nice route here, clearing out everything back, finishing the run back on the red armor. That's how you do it. You want to finish your run, just go through the map, try to take away as much as you can, and then finish it on the most important area, and just recontrol that one. So perfectly done by Winz. Textbook stuff. And it looks like it should be a good start here for Meltdown. Is actually right now they have what they need to just start generating a lot of kills, and they're very efficient players, so we should start seeing this scoreline separate quite a bit, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it was a shame for Deliberate Murder that Cooler simply wasn't really ready to pick up a power-up. You saw that he had just a machine gun at 100 health. It's like he just spawned next to it. Oh, Winz! No, that's your close buddy.
Oh no, that totally changed the world, actually.
Wow, Latrommi just clears up right there. And that all kind of stemmed from Linkin killing his teammate, essentially. They lost all the manpower by the lightning gun, and Latrommi just comes in and is like, thank you.
Yeah, the rough thing there as well is that they also lost them their red runner, so now they've lost a major area of the map, so what I thought would be them taking the lead, actually, in a matter of seconds, thanks to Linkin, it's still gone down the toilet.
Yeah, I want to say all the people watching, though, you might think that DDK is a master of CS now with his analytical skills, but he's really a TDM expert, so we've got some excellent analysis for us today. I'll be learning from DDK, I'm sure of it.
Yeah, Ragnarok is a new thing for me, but we'll see how it goes. And at the moment, again, we're going to have the power-ups going towards Linkin now. Winz the first battle suit runner, now it's Linkin.
Wow.
This is really good stuff. Link is one of the best players when it comes to power running in the game. When his movement is so
he's
amazing.
He's got the energy in his player. He doesn't mind rocket jumping. Even if he's got a quad damage, I mean, we've seen him at events that he's just like, whatever, I'm going to go absolutely crazy and do something the opponent's really not going to expect.
And we saw the quad damage guy running away from him there, just giving him the red armor rune. So again, Link is going to be controlling the red, and he just needs to hold this area for his team and just make sure that he can support them so they can keep getting the red armors. And there's only spawning for another 12 seconds, so it looks like he wants to do some damage before he goes back up there. And we should see him doing that shortly. So here he goes, back up into the red armor rune, trying to do as much as he possibly can. He was the only player really with anything on his team, so he wanted to try to stretch himself, but it's like a deliberate murder actually going to be able to win back the lightning gun room.
Yeah, and we've definitely got to explain to some of the viewers watching as well that this is very different to Duel. The weapons here spawn every 30 seconds, not every 5 seconds. So controlling the weapon rooms can be extremely difficult for some teams to do. And that, and of course, when you die, you drop your weapon. So it's very important that you try to drop either a weapon that's not very valuable, or you switch to the gauntlet like you may have seen Linkin doing earlier just before he died. And so he doesn't give anything extra to his opponents.
Yeah, and so the lightning gun, as you can see, is so much focus around this area just because of how important how efficient it is to deal damage in these open areas, and also at the red armor room, as we're about to see. We're about to see here. It's a really nice room for lightning gun as well.
It's a pretty map in general.
It's gorgeous, yeah. It's really gorgeous. But the powers are spawning soon, Zyrinx.
Yep.
We'll Meltdown get another battle suit, because they've been doing really well there so far.
I think we're going to see a Tox run, to be honest. He is absolutely stacked. 150 armor. Battlesuit up in 2 seconds. It looks like Deliberate Murder trying to get some damage on him, but they've barely scratched his armor. And let's see what he can do with this. There is going to be a quad taken by a Russian. It's Cooler who's got the quad, and he looks a little bit more prepared than the first time we saw him with the quad damage. Tox looks like he doesn't want to chase him. He's just going to get kills on his, Cooler's weaker teammates.
A really nice conservative play there from Tox. He knew that he did enough against the quad damage. I mean, Cooler's been forced to just back away. And once again, Meltdown have taken the major areas of the map. So despite there being some back and forth, Meltdown are starting to really pull ahead just because of their ability to do more damage on these power-up runs. Because every time there's a power-up, they get the battle suit, and they're actually able to convert it into more map control. So they're getting more armor than their opponents, which allows them to survive longer, get more kills. Very simple stuff, but it's being effective. And the aim on these guys is so good. Like, it's very impressive.
Yeah. I mean, Linkin has actually been criticized recently for his aim becoming weaker, but I haven't seen any signs of poor aim from him at all. Oh, winz falling into lava. And winz and Linkin are inseparable when it comes to them playing in teams, and those guys are usually, masters of aim generally, but I feel like winz might be the stronger in that area at the moment.
Yes.
Linkin, though, he's getting the frags, so proving me wrong at the moment.
Yeah, there's another like 40 seconds or so until the power-ups are going to be spawning. And the power-ups are kind of crazy in this map because they're so close together. Everything is quite close together in this map. It's actually a deceptively small map, I think. And right now we can see once again Linkin running around, just trying to do as much damage as possible to these players and get himself back into the red. So they need to start trying to stack somebody up here, if they possibly can, to get that next power-up. The battle suit has been so effective for them, Meltdown, that is. So Deliberate Murder, they really need to try to deny that control of it.
Another player I'd like to talk about is Fortune, actually. He seems to be sort of a core support player in any top Russian team playing lineup, essentially. This guy is someone who doesn't really get enough praise for the work he does, but hopefully we'll see some great stuff from him later on. We are watching zyrinx at the moment, who managed to get in battle suit, and the red armor straight after is really going to beef him up a lot. To see if he can combat the quad at any time, or just, as you saw before, picking off these guys which don't have the power up. The shotgun has been, I'd say, relatively ineffective at the moment, but it's chipping away at the enemy, weakening them a lot, so it's definitely Zyrinx's teammates likely going to be able to pick up some frags around him, unless that quad, which I'm not sure what happened to it during that full 30 seconds.
Yeah, the cool thing about the battlesuit as well is even if Zyrinx can't do a lot of damage or make a lot of kills, it creates a lot of space for his team because the opponents can't fight him as well. Even if he can't kill them, they can't really fight him. So they'd rather choose to run away and save their health and armor instead of using it in a futile attempt to try to hurt a guy who's got like really high levels of protection with the battle suit. So he created a lot of space for his team there. We can see actually Latrommi working his way towards the red, but he's running low on the ammo here on the railgun. He's going to be able to steal away that red armor. Let's see if winz can do more damage here. Latrommi can actually get away. That'd be really nice to get away. Unfortunately, he can't build this straight into a power-up, which would be a lot of frags, but he said he's going to just try to escape here. And he's doing an excellent job. He's going to be able to take weapons away to his teammates, maybe drop some weapons as well to some fresh spawners. And this is a good effort so far, but he's starting to get a bit low. Keeps the pressure on towards LG and back to red again. So it looks like his team are trying to go for this, but he's just going to go and die. They didn't really have the timing, the coordination there to attack the red together.
They're running out of resources as well. Latrommi was just getting low on ammo, health, everything. He's alright. That's the teammate there did just get fragged in order to pick up the ammunition, full ammunition on the weapon they currently had in their hand. So there wasn't just a sadistic play from the team.
Yeah,
unless they got angry at each other.
Yeah, you can also expect as the power's coming that Zyrinx can make multiple kills with that.
Mm-hmm.
That LG is really, really strong. So here we go. We're gonna have the run from Linkin again with a battle suit. And one of the things that makes him so strong is his movement is so damn fluid when he's in these high-paced, high-octane scenarios. And he's gonna be finishing back onto the red armor now. But it's not spawning for a while, so he's gonna waste a lot of his battle suit being here. He does have some weapons to work with, but it's always gonna be more important to try to control items and areas than it will be to just run for like one or two kills, because those items can help you, your teammates, they can turn into 5 or 10 kills later down the line. So safe play there, it was a must.
I managed to get a couple more kills before he goes down. I really want to see a bit more of Latrommi later on when he manages to get a bit more stack, because that guy is such a joy to watch when he is hitting rockets or whatever weapon he might have. Got Zyrinx here, who has actually got a little bit of armor for himself. This is the railgun area, trying to keep control of this. But it looks like he's being absolutely surrounded, trying to keep them out of there, but only 8 health left. He's going to drop that gun for a teammate. And they've actually managed to clear up the opponents beside him.
A very chaotic map, this one. It's like a big cave. It's just very, mm-hmm. very, very small. You're so fast between all the major items. And here we go. We've got another attack coming in from Fortune this time onto that red armor. He's going to be able to eliminate the enemies who were in the vicinity, and nicely done by Pavel. So we'll get the extra frags, but Toxic will spawn the rocket launcher. That's a bit of a disaster there for Pavel, but they should still be able to get the one or two can still pick up that red armor, so it should be fine. And we do have the power spawning in 20 seconds. So this is the kind of territory where you want to start building somebody up. And we can see Kula here for Deliberate Murder is really strong. So if he can just save this stack to just land on a power up, that is going to be absolutely massive for his team.
He's got some opponents to fight though. They might try and whittle down his stack a bit. Even at this point, if he can maintain this, he'll be looking good for a power up. And that battle suit's going to be up in 3 seconds. Have his teammates got it? Problem is, there's no more weapons left, only a railgun for Kula. And we're going to see Winz with the quad damage.
Yeah, I mean, Kula went for the railgun there, but it's kind of a shame he didn't go for a challenge on the power up save, because we can see, although Pavel did pick it up, Kula was so stacked, and the opposing team, Meltdown, they didn't manage to pick up the core damage, and so I think there could have been a challenge there from Kula. But we'll see if Linkin can get something done here with this quad. He's only going to get one frag there in the end, and it's going to be Latrommi who cleans him up. So looks like actually we're going to get a resurgence here from the Russians, from Deliberate Murder, as they work control back onto the map. They've gained a lot of frags here as well.
Yeah, they were getting down to about 30 frags a difference there. MD were getting so far ahead in this game, but they're building it up back very nicely. Do we have a mercy limit on this server? Often games are like, if you get a 50 frag advantage, then it's game over for you. Lights out. Apparently, Muzen, there's no mercy limit, so we have 20 full minutes of action, no matter what happens. But it doesn't seem to matter for these guys, because they're keeping it pretty close anyway. And if Deliberate Murder are able to keep control of the map, then surely this is possible for them to come back from.
Yeah, absolutely. They've already shown that they like understand how to bring themselves back. They've been doing it already, of course, and it's all about these power-ups, to be honest. Now, can we see anything better from... oh my god, that's...
Defending red like that was amazing. And that's all they were trying to do. There was this big rampage in there. Well, chaotic orgy of action, essentially. And MD managed to win back the red armor.
This battle pursuit has been so key, because again, we're talking about that ability to like push people out of areas even if you can't frag them. Battle suit does that incredibly well.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy who's finishing on the quad has never been that strong as well. So if they can actually create a situation where they can delay the quad a bit so they can get the battle suit and then just run onto the quad so they get the double stack power up. It's going to be really one-sided, but this time Cooler's going to pick up the quad here. Now, typically the quad damage guy hasn't been doing a lot, but Cooler's really stacked here. He's got an LG, a shotgun, he's got the perfect combo to just wreck anyone on the map, so this should be sick from Deliberate Murder.
This needs to be a great run as well. That red spawning in a second, but it looks like Cooler really wants some frags. He's being alerted by teammates where the opponents are, so he can try and pick up these kills. But killing the battle suit is going to be very difficult for him to do that. And his health, he's on 1 HP. He's surely going to die right now. There we go. Zyrinx on the corner, finding the last point of damage.
That's the perfect example of how dangerous the battle suit can be, because even if you're pretty stacked as the quad carrier, just trying to kill the battle suit can be so awkward because it takes so much to kill him that you're going to waste a lot of resources in that effort. So it's very important for both of these teams so far that even if they give up the quad damage, that they hold onto the battle suit or vice versa. Because if one team gets both, that's when we're going to start seeing a ridiculous spread on the scoreline. But we see Meltdown defended that so well that they're actually extending their lead again.
Yeah, no, they had a moment where they brought it back to sort of 16, 17 frags apart, but it's stretched back out. And I really think that fight over at the Red Armor is kind of what changed it. If Deliberate Murder were able to keep control of that Red Room at that point, then it would have allowed them to go on for a little bit longer and maybe bring it back to 10 frags before they'd have to challenge again massively for another room. And that, of course, depends if MD want to continue challenging or if they want to play it defensively and just stay exclusively on the other side of the map.
Yeah. And Toxic, as you said, like, you know, bringing that control back to red, that could have been the double power up for Deliberate Murder indeed. And this guy, he used to be in the legendary lineup Ice Climbers, which was one of the most dominant, if not most dominant, TDM team ever in the most competitive time for Quake 3 TDM. And he made his name on just being a TDM aim star, someone who did always ridiculous damage. His efficiency was ridiculous, but he never played efficient. He would just run at you, and somehow he'd always do so much damage.
Yeah, can't do anything.
Yeah, he's a very, very strong player. Wins back with the quad now as well, and looks like Pavel's going to pick up the red with the battle suit, so this could be really good here for Deliberate Murder. Can he actually pull it off?
Pavel hit an amazing rocket there, but he's not able to quite follow up and get the final blast on Winz, who's still doing amazing damage with the rocket launcher. Wow. And when you've got quad versus battle suit, the quad's still doing pretty damn good damage versus that guy.
Yeah, and it's one thing to note as well, unless it's a direct rocket, it's not going to actually hurt the battle suit guy, because the splash damage doesn't do anything against the battle suit. Mm. So the rocket launcher can be really good as a quad guy to bounce them away, but as we can see there, bounced them towards the quad carrier, so that kind of sucked. But yeah, it looks like this is starting to get pretty dominant right now for Meltdown. They're really starting to pull ahead. Almost 30 frags difference again.
It's also must be noted that although it's called quad damage, I think it only does times 3 damage.
Yeah, yeah. The poor man's quad damage.
And it was different once upon a time, but
now it's just Quake Quad that has the 4 times. Mm.
Latrommi getting stuck in the water a little bit. He's just not able to move whatsoever. It's going to be a sitting duck there. Easy pickings. Zhang's not being doing too bad at the moment. Getting a little excellent there for himself. It's going to be interesting to look at the scoreboard towards the end to see where the damage is really stacking up. And we've been seeing a lot of cool plays from everyone. I think Zyrinx had a slight embarrassment earlier when he just jumped into the lava. But other than that, I mean, we've seen some great stuff from him. Any standout players for you without us being able to look at the scoreboard? Anyone standing out for you?
I think Toxic and Linkin have been standouts as far as Meltdown go, because Toxic has just been, of course, very efficient at just doing a lot of damage all the time. Whenever we see him, he's always doing like a 3-to-1 damage ratio, it seems like. And as far as like Linkin goes as well, he's always just placing himself around the power-ups very well. And we've seen him pick up a lot of the battle suits, and that's made a huge difference for Meltdown. This time we see Cooler on the quad again. He's been one of the most notables, I think, for this lineup here, for Deliberate Murder. He will get multiple kills here with that quad damage, but he will go down eventually. And that's kind of the problem, because he got a few frags, but he wasn't able to turn that into some kind of control on items for his team. So he wasn't winning his team many more resources with that. And that's what the battle suit keeps continuously doing for Meltdown. That's been the biggest difference. They've had so many battle suits compared to Deliberate Murder.
And battle suits are the more desirable power up, right?
Yeah, in this on this map, in this case, I think absolutely. Yeah, it's been very effective so far, clearing out these areas. And this map, it seems very chaotic because there isn't really anywhere to hide in in the main areas where you want to pick up the items. You're back in the quadroom here, and just look how open everything is. If you want to have a fight, or if you want to just retain your armor, it's very difficult because you're going to be hit from all sides constantly. So this map seems to be so much about the team that's got more individual skill and can more effectively over time assert that individual skill just by hitting more of the shots and having better dodging and so on.
Now, I think we should talk about some of the lineup roles later on as we before we switch over to the next map. But with 23 frags now advantage for Meltdown and just one more set of power-ups left on the map, I mean, it's looking like unless something miraculous happens for the Deliberate Murder lineup, then it will, as we predicted, it's going to be them having to come back on Dreadful Place to tie up the series. First part of the first series. What? However, the tiebreaker for tiebreaker situation is going to work.
Yeah, it's the role stuff is actually very interesting. It can be quite simple or quite convoluted depending on the map and depending on the player.
Mm-hmm.
As you mentioned, we're going to be closing this map, so we can say that for the post game. As Win's going to pick up the quad, and he's going to get the. What happens to the battle suit, I wonder? Not sure.
Is this man a weapon?
He's chilling on the LG. Right, there it is, going to spawn for him. He's receiving a lot of damage, though. Of course, the quad does not protect you, just multiplies your damage by three, as you mentioned, so it can be quite difficult to survive with it. The battle suit's much more consistent in that sense, because also your teammates can go and drop you weapons, and that's always going to help you out. And that was also, that's something new in Quake Live for Quake 3 TDM, the ability to drop weapons. Being able to drop weapons changed the dynamic a lot, because you sometimes just want to hold areas because there was a lot of weapons that, or like a lot of fights that happened, and you want to like get your teammates, you're going to call them, okay, loads of guns over here, and you know, to try and you know, strengthen the next push on an item. But in this game, you can kind of, you don't have to worry about that. You can just pick up the weapons and then drop them to your teammates as you find them.
Yeah. The whole dropping for your teammates is far more common in TDM than in CTF. You might pile up your defender, in CTF, but in TDM it's very much, okay, which player needs something. We all need to be able to fight equally and get stacked up. And with these 5 seconds left, we're going to be watching Tox at the end of the map here as Meltdown Bar are going to be taking it 170 to 150. So, and look at the damage there, 7.9k on winz, 8.4 on Linkin. Actually, it's Cooler getting top damage for himself. Latrommi, very close behind. And actually, Cooler's not the guy I would traditionally associate as being the sort of the damage master. He's generally the sort of the team leader. He's going to say, right, I will dictate which room needs to be controlled when, and I will control where we should be going. Fortune's going to be like, right, I'll support you. I'll be with that every time. And any good weapon I get, then Pavel, Latrommi, the two tanks of the team, essentially. It's like, I'm going to provide these guys with the resources they need in order to go on their rampages. And Latrommi and Pavel, as I mentioned, they are the damage dealers. They are the guys that should be getting the power-ups generally. They should be getting the armors, and they just should be hitting absolutely everything. But Cooler, he was looking brilliant there.
Yeah, I mean, it could be because of his dueling roots. They might say, mm-hmm. Okay, we want you to make sure that you're picking up the items, like that you're running maybe the YAs or the shards, you know, just various items. Keep control of that, and then we're gonna get the control of the power-up area for you to then take it when you're stacked. Instead of saying we want you to be active all the time on the map, like they would be. So I think that could make sense, and might be the reason why Cooler has been the power-up man in this scenario, which is also why we saw him take loads of quads. We saw, of course, him having the best efficiency, which should happen with that kind of a role. But the interesting thing with players from the other lineup, from Meltdown, is that you've got such a good lineup here because the way that Zyrinx used to play, and of course it will always change in this lineup because this is just a crazy lineup. Zyrinx used to be this guy where he could basically disappear for a little bit, and as his team, you just want to try to support, keep presence on items, keep presence on all the areas to make sure that the other team isn't getting too stacked up, and then basically win him items here and there. Then eventually he comes around with some armor, with a railgun, with maybe a lightning gun, and then he will just wreck everyone from the outskirts of the map. And that's the kind of player that Zyrinx is. He's very, very good with items. Toxic is probably one of the best players in the business with no items.
Yeah.
He'll always deliver with no items, and that's why he's so important.
And we've got Dreadful Place now that has just started here between Deliberate Murder and Meltdown. And this is a very different map to the last one. We've only got one power-up here, so these teams are going to be fighting for quad damage every 2 minutes. The power-up spawns between the 30th second of the game and the 60th second of the game, and it's absolutely random. So we will see that appear any... Well, we can see ourselves 5 seconds time. The players have no idea, so they're going to have to move over very soon as it's a relatively early power-up, and Linkin is going to get the first one.
Yeah, it can be a bit gambly, but yeah, Linkin, again, one of the best power-up runners. He's so fluid. That's probably the best way I can describe him. He's already going to pick up the first frag there with the red armor to spawn in front of him. And, of course, the next LG is very soon, but he's actually not going to go to LG. He's going to go down towards the railgun instead and then back up towards Mega. So a different route by Linkin, probably because he's quite low on health and his teammates are providing some good support initially towards the lightning gun. So his route's been really nice. What a rail there. That was a very clutch shot. If he missed that, he would go down. And he's carrying a lot of weapons right now. You can see he's just divvying those out to his teammates. He's going to actually pick up the Mega as well. So he's healthy again. Back in time for the red. You can see it's such a good run here from Linkin. He's doing very, very well. Hold it. Okay, looks good still.
Russians are just dying everywhere. What is going on at the moment? This is usually the map where Deliberate Murder, that's where they live, essentially. They're so good at this map on TDM. But Meltdown, they've had an amazing start over here. Linkin with the quad damage, even though he had so little health and armor to work with, he was getting a couple of frags that he needed and getting back to some important items afterwards, as you were mentioning earlier.
Yeah, he's running the route really well, and this map is incredibly important to try to actually control. Like, the most efficient way to play this map, if you can do it, it's the hardest way, is to take the lightning gun, run the LG, run this YA that we just saw, Latrommi pass, and also have control of the railgun, which is where Latrommi's going now, which is in this lower area, which you have to time. The weapons spawn every 30 seconds, and you want to always be taking the rails and the LGs away from the opponent, and then you can just duck in for the red whenever you choose, and then finish on the quad, because you have better positioning there. You can see the very early turn up for quad here, and it tends to change on this map. On the teams, it's almost like a mutual agreement how early the teams are going to turn up.
Yeah.
Because some teams can turn up 30 seconds early, and that can actually cause a lot of problems sometimes for the opposing side.
Sometimes it's just they'll turn up 2 seconds beforehand and go for a quick rush and maybe go for a steal. Deliberate Murder, they lost the early securing of it. Pavel just jumps in and he takes it away. That was a kamikaze move. He's trying to hit some final shots to at least keep this quad damage, but his health slowly trickles down. And MD will manage to resecure the area and, well, their lives, basically, because Pavel was putting them at great risk just then.
Yeah, quad running in this game is all about how clutch you are, because, like, Linkin, for example, is one of the most clutch quad runners I've ever seen, I think, as well as players like Toxic. They're very, very, very good with the quad because you only get one chance for a shot, but if you get that shot, that hit that rail, the momentum you generate is insane, and the amount of control and frags you can start creating for your team is really ridiculous. So I think that's something for any of the CSVs who haven't seen Quake before to watch out for. Those are the very clutch moments, but right now, Toxic's just trying to poke around. He's got good armor as well, and Meltdown, they're starting to lose a few frags all because of that quad steal. That really hurt the overall map control of Meltdown.
Yeah. And also for the CS viewers, in TDM, right now you can see if you get a power-up, it's you that picks it up, and if you die, the power-up disappears as well. When we watch some CTF later, that power-up can continue after a player dies, so it will fall on the floor again, and then another player can pick it up. And you can even drop it and try and play more strategically with it, with your teammates. But we will pick up on that later on, as it looks like MD have got tight control of this red armor room, although they are being pretty wary in case someone pushes in, as they don't have that many resources at the moment. But
this is the problem, actually, because they've lost control of the weapons, and you can see that they're like, okay, we don't have the times necessarily, or we don't have the power to take them after that awesome quad steal from Pavel, I think it was. Although he didn't get a lot of kills, this is the thing that, the reason why 1 and 2 are so good at this map, or Deliberate Murder, is because they're so good at running these weapons, the mega side of the room with all the weapons. They're so good at that, and that's the strongest way to play the map, and right now it's actually winning them frags back. But if they don't get this quad, we might just see the same story all over again from Meltdown. It's about to spawn in. Toxic looks pretty stacked for it.
And there's no last second rush from Pavel there, where he's not able to secure the power up as well. Maybe they're just cutting their losses a bit and trying to get control of the rest of the map. Do you think that's a possibility?
Yeah, sometimes you can realize, okay, we just don't have a shot at this, and you can try to play defensive. It's really risky, though, against a team like Meltdown, which have such sick aimers. See, Toxic not missing a beat with the shotgun he's going to take. Triple kill there, right over the LG. He'll take the time for his team as well, so they know when the LG is spawning. So this is actually... Meltdown should be able to actually build this as they have a red armor time. They should be able to build it into another 10 or 15 frags in the next minute or so, I think.
It was a really nice positioning as well from Tox, because, you know, one thing... Oh my god, that lightning gun. Wow. One thing you can do if you're trying to kill the quad carry is you can, like, your entire team basically just rush in down so that you kind of overpower him completely. But Tox is putting himself in an amazing position where they couldn't really get close to him without, you know, going through that choke point where he'd immediately get a frag with a shotgun or whatever weapon he was choosing.
Yeah, and the shotgun does 100 damage up close. It used to do 110 back in the old Quake 3 days, but in Quake Live it does 100 now.
It changed around in Quake Live early on as well, I think.
Yeah, you're right, actually. More. Yeah, it was the same before, wasn't it?
Yeah, they had to nerf it hard.
It is 100 now, right?
Yes, I believe so.
Cool. So I think they changed like the amount of pellets, the spread. They actually messed with it quite a lot, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, we have Zyrinx here. We can see that he's trying to run that mega health, but he's going to actually lose it out to Deliberate Murder. And again, that's another reason why they're strong here. They're keeping the difference because of their ability to pick up the items. But the fragging difference on Meltdown is kind of clear at the moment. And they are definitely overpowering Deliberate Murder. So they're really going to need a good power-up run. And if they can then lock down the map with all the items, they could actually win this map. But right now, it's not looking like... I mean, there's a lot of time left. But they got to be careful that the difference doesn't get too overwhelming.
I think if Deliberate Murder are able to get some map control, then I honestly don't doubt that they'll be able to get back in this game and bring themselves into the lead. But Tox now with the power-up once again, he's very low on armor, but when he's got these weapons, it almost doesn't really matter. As long as he's not going up against a railgun or anything right now, he should be able to pick up a couple more kills. This is 3 frags so far on this run. He gets the yellow armor, and he's looking a little better off now. That red was taken recently. Not sure if a teammate took that, actually, of his.
Yeah, just one of those runs where you just can't really find too many people. Happens sometimes.
You know, 3 frags on a quad run is actually not bad for this map. You know, when you're talking about an amazing quad run, it's being able to kill the entire team and maybe one more. And then if you say you got, oh wow, I got 5 frags on a quad run on a dreadful place, that's like, wow, that's pretty impressive. And sometimes, you know, Linkin, Tox, the type of guys that can get a lot more sometimes if maybe the enemy team are unfortunate spawns, the way these guys are able to move around the map. But as well, Latrommi, Pavel, I feel like we haven't had a chance to really see them shine on this map just yet. We saw some nice moves from Pavel earlier on, but I think we'll have to be a bit patient. What exactly does Deliberate Murder have to do right now, though, to get that control on the map? What's going wrong for them?
Well, the thing is, I think they're just getting overpowered in a lot of the fights, and because the resources haven't really been a huge issue, the one thing that is quite clear is that Meltdown have been getting more quads, and the fact that they haven't generated more frags out of that means that they're not converting super well onto map control as well as they'd like. And that's kind of the part of the strength of Deliberate Murder, but Deliberate Murder need to finish on a quad here. The last few quads, we've seen that Meltdown just turned up there like 10-15 seconds before, and there's been not a huge amount of resistance from Deliberate Murder. So they need a really successful quad attack, and that can be hard. You've got to muster everything you can, just move in. Every weapon in this game is very useful situationally. Like shotguns super close, there's loads of shotguns in this map. Get close to the shotguns, find the choke points, get some good damage in, and well, Toxic is still controlling the Mega, so this is going to be tough as the quad is spawning now. And again, it looks like, oh, this is going to be rough. Look at how stacked he is. This is going to be really rough.
He needs some algae. He spots the ammo crate, and he's going to be able to pick that up. He has got so many resources right now. And with that many weapons, you would assume he probably hasn't died for a minute.
There's
2 quick frags there on some Russians. He's going to find one right off the spawn. Cooler, and going to go down to the LG. Tox running out of health and armor at the moment, but he should be good for a couple more kills. Yeah, Latrommi going to go down. That's 4 frags now on this run. I mean, that's already amazing, and he's got the mega health right next to him if he wants it. But actually, going down is fairly dangerous. He might give that up for a teammate. And honestly, he should drop some weapons soon. It's taking a big risk when you've got all those important weapons. You give those to your teammates with more health, and you're ready to continue control of the map for another decent period of time.
Yeah, I think he was looking for the 50 there before picking the Mega up, but it just wasn't up. And we can see the impact here. Akula wants to get up here into this LG room so that his teammates can recontrol it, but all the item times are now in control of Meltdown. So if they're able to hold on well to the item times and efficiently play around the items without losing too much health and armor, just always be able to have a strong fight on the item, then they can really lock this one down. But that's one of the harder parts of playing this map, is locking down all the items, because there's a lot of important items on this map. And we've got, oh nice, Rocket there. So Toxic steals away the Mega again, but Cooler got the time now. And also, Deliberate Murder got the time on the LG. So they're still not out of this. They still know what's going on the map. So, and that's half of the battle on Dreadful Place. So let's see if they can keep turning things into their favor. But another attack into the Mega Room here could be very, very damaging as the quad is coming up in 30 seconds.
As long as Cooler has the info, then he can still lead some good strats going through the map. So this is getting to the sort of score line which was near max of what it was on Ragnarok. Deliberate Mode is going to have to start pulling it back right now. Going past halfway, sure, as long as they slow things down and Deliberate Mode don't get too far behind anymore.
This is it.
Then no. they can start building up the comeback within the next 3-4 minutes.
Latrommi, no, he's doing a lot of damage there with the quad and...
Oh, Zyrinx managed to get it in the end. We still got him. Yep, Zyrinx. There he is on the quad.
Yeah, so this is a bit of a shame. It's a much better job going for that quad. That could have been a Deliberate Murder, and actually it will be eliminated. I think this is the first time the quad has actually been eliminated by Deliberate Murder, and Cooler's so strong afterwards as well. Now this is a
massive frag. That's really big.
Has to be the point of turnaround for Deliberate Murder. They have to hold onto the map until the next quad, pick up the next quad, and Cooler's trying to just work onto the railgun area here, but he's taking too much damage and his teammates are not able to support him properly. This is the problem. It's like hard to like. How many players do you split into attacking the LG, into attacking the rail? Because they're going to be often spawning fairly close together. So it's very hard to decide how to make that happen. It's one of the hardest parts about this map.
Kills are happening though right now for the Deliberate Murder guys. You know, even though Cooler had to turn back from the railgun room and move away, he had already done a lot of damage just then. Sure, he didn't deny the weapons or anything, but his teammates are getting the items. It's not so bad for Deliberate Murder at the moment. Although I'm finding it hard to get the picture of what's going on with the rest of his teammates. We're seeing just these frag messages at the top left going happening over and over. I think Linkin killed himself.
Yeah, this is a problem actually, because Cooler's position there, we saw him by the LG. He was trying to, he had armor. He was trying to run the LG and the yellow. Now, usually when you've got a player doing this, it can be really, really powerful, because the idea is that you always want one player that's strong, so that can drop weapons, is always picking stuff up and getting kills on these enemies that are approaching into these areas. He's always surviving and he's always able to have the items under control. But he needs support. You need to keep him alive. And we saw there that Cooler was not able to stay alive because he had no one to buffer for him in that fight around the LG. If he stays alive there, if he's got teammate support, then we could see a very different situation. But, you know, this is just happening too much. They can't keep Cooler alive. And he seems to be a very pivotal... He's in that pivotal role right now.
Yeah. Latrommi is actually doing a lot of work as well for Deliberate Murder at the moment. But it's Pavel and Fortune that were down at negative 16 net, something like that. And the only guy similar to that on MD was Zyrinx, I think negative 14. I mean, the rest of MD were doing exceptionally well. And look at that, MD locking down this quad. Four players are over here. Quad up in 2 seconds. You can see that on the fringe of this area, Deliberate Murder are trying to do something, but it's going to be yet another quad damage for these guys. 42 frags they have ahead of the Russians.
Yeah, Rocket will send Toxic away, so... Nice kill on the spawner, but how much more is he going to find? He's up against the rocket. The grenades there.
Wow, beautiful Tox. Stuff. Oh my God, he makes it look so easy, but that is amazing awareness. He's got great information coming from his teammates, and great game sense. That's a really good quad run, actually. Being able to get that much out of the little amount of health that he was working with, amazing.
He's just hit five of five rails there, and he's. Looking to do more here, he's taking control of this area, and there's also a rail slug box at the end of this corridor. It's not spawned, I don't think, but Toxic will just keep the frags, just racking them up at the moment for his team, and this is really painful, because right now this is a period where everyone just got reset on Deliberate Murder, so no one has anything, and this is dangerous as well, because you can also lose all the times on the map when in a situation like this. But we'll have to see if Cooler's on top of that, or who's actually able to get something happening for... Deliberate Murder, but so far it looks like they are really lacking options.
Tox is just shredding them, honestly. And it's just a Tox show right now.
Put the rail out again.
Even when you think he's about to go down, he's just still going. He's just still doing amazing damage. Gets a 50 health bubble. And that, you know, Tox, a 50 health bubble to Tox is like a red armor to sort of Fortune or Latrommi at this point. He doesn't need much to be able to keep going at full speed. Two more rails. This is just insane. You shouldn't be able to do this much damage while being on only 60 health.
Yeah, he's almost survived for 2 minutes, and he's had very little health and armor to sustain him during this period, considering the amount of fights he's been in and the amount of kills he's killed. He's killed people. I mean, I think he's gone like plus 10 or 12 frags in like the last couple minutes. So this guy is
How is he not dead yet? He's going to get the yellow armor and eventually pulled away from Tox's point of view. to go to Zyrinx is now he's got the quad damage. I feel like Tox has got a permanent quad damage or something. I'm still staggered that he was able to do so much of that. He just wasted all of his ammunition on pretty much all of his weapons. And he really needs a top up. But Zyrinx getting one frag with this quad so far. I make that two now. And he doesn't even need to do that much. His team has got such a good lead. This should carry them through to the end.
Yeah, I mean, if you consider what Toxic was able to do in those 2 minutes, he was basically by himself completely disrupting the kind of secondary items and areas of the map by himself, whilst the rest of the teammates were stacking up, getting weapons. Oh, we see Zyrinx able to just take a quad with no resistance. But that's all because Toxic did so much work. So Toxic doesn't even have to bother showing a quad because he's doing so much damage that they won't have anything to attack quad with, firstly. And secondly, they're too distracted, and Toxic's done so much that it's an easy quad for his team. So now they've gone like so far ahead in that 2 minute period. Toxic with that super efficient play. I mean, that is just some star power from Meltdown. They're full of star power though.
I mean, there were a lot of people wondering how would the good deliberate murder lineup go up against the top unknown lineup. It's kind of like what Meltdown is, although Zyrinx being exchanged for someone. I think right now, Meltdown look sick.
Yeah, I mean,
they are looking really, really good in TDM. I'm finding it very hard to imagine a team being able to beat them.
Yeah, if you're from the CS world, it's like having, you know, four get rights on your team or four guardians or something like that. You know, you have four star players basically on the same team.
Yeah.
You can take any one of these players and put them in another lineup of just Premier League players that aren't star players. And you can make a really sick team around them, basically. That's what these four guys are. And that's why they're so damn scary. And we're seeing already almost a 60 frag difference. Finally, Deliberate Murder will get a quad, and Kula's managed to find that. He's got LG, he's got a lot of armor as well. So let's see if they can get some constellation frags at the very least, because I'm not sure if they, in 3 minutes, they can pick up 50. So here we go, Kula just electrocuting multiple players as he runs the routes through the map. He's going to get a few frags, and they are cleaning up and resetting everyone, but still.
A nice quad run as well, but it's a shame that it means so little at this point. I think, what do you get, five frags with the quad at the end there? And Wynn's actually taking down all his resources, and he's eventually going to kill him, and Kula really would have wanted to continue that. But 2.5 minutes to get this many kills. And MD getting a win like this on Deliberate Murder's home map, I mean, that's a statement and a half right there.
Yeah, it's pretty rough.
I know, having spoken to Linkin, he was massively upset about how his team games at Quakecon last year went. And looks like he has got some players around him that are pretty thirsty for victory.
Yeah, it's again, one of these spots where on this map, one of the most important ways to play it is to just be always able to just run the LG, and run as many items as you can around it. Usually the easiest way is to get one guy running the yellow behind, because that's quite a kind of like a safe area. It's a jump pad, it's kind of hard to attack into it. It should be easier, there should be less traffic of players around the area. So it's safer to build someone up that way, then he can jump onto the mega and get really stacked. But when you have players of the level of Meltdown, their aim is so good that their damage output is always going to be so high that it's very hard to keep a player like that alive.
Yeah.
So, and that's, I think, been a huge issue. And it also means that a team like Meltdown, they don't even need a wealth of strategy, because so long as they are good at just, you know, team playing, knowing just generally where they should be, they don't have to make it complicated. They can just run around together, apply basic team play, and use their 6 star power to just absolutely wreck their opposition.
Just a sort of thought on the side while we got Linkin with this quad run. Be really awesome if I had like a wish list for things I'd like at Quakecon. It's definitely like a DPS meter you can put up, so you could see the average DPS of each team. I think that would be something very interesting to have. But we've got 4 frags right now for Linkin. He's got so much health and armor. He's going to be able to pick up more and more. Where are the spawns? Is anyone going to be at the rocket? Going to get himself that meaning SLG and last frag. Well, just after his quad ends.
This when it comes to stuff like this, there's lots of stuff that Linkin's doing, like especially against rockets and weapons like that. Like these very, very tiny kind of elements of movement where he's either, you know, backing off or just, you know, moving right or left or forwards at the exact right timings to kind of throw you off. So he gets maximum damage, and he almost baits you into his crosshairs, as well as tricking you, making you think he's going to move here when he's actually moving somewhere else. It's very, very slight, and these slight nuances, but players of that level have that ability. It's actually the same in CS as well. There's actually an element of that. Dodging isn't as huge in that game, but there's a distinct element of very nuanced play around movement.
Yeah.
So amazing in-fight stuff from these Meltdown guys.
Look at Tox's damage as well. 8.9k, over 1,000 ahead of any of his teammates. Latrommi looking great for his team there. 7.7k. I mean, he's around there with the MD players, but teammates not really able to push out all that damage. Zyrinx at negative 16, but Pavel, Fortune, over passing the negative 20s. Latrommi and Cooler can't even remain positive there. Obviously, a lot more stats we could look at, though. But we need some kind of a match report going on that. But we have got CTF coming up quite soon. We got a taster of some TDM there. Was honestly expecting that to be closer.
I wasn't really, because the thing is that they're just so good. Again, it's like four star players. Mm-hmm. They are so, so experienced in TDM, all of them as well. And as you said, winz and Linkin have played together forever. Toxic was kind of the star player on the greatest Quake 3 TDM line of all time. And Zyrinx as well. He was actually a newcomer, essentially. He's always been around. I played with him for quite a long time in some Euro Cups, and that guy's just really sick as well. He's such a talented player.
Yeah.
So, and the thing is that these guys are so good at CTF as well, Z. Linkin's exactly. like the best mover. Toxic's like the best defender.
It's a master lineup, really. But I really thought that Deliberate Murder would have that sort of brain game behind them. They'd have the ability to coordinate themselves to make those jump rushes all at the same time. You know, the 3-2-1 they call it, and everything just happens. To be able to cycle weapons, have that control of the exact timing of maybe three or four weapons, and then all of the items basically. You expect them to have meticulous timing on everything, but that didn't really seem to matter.
Yeah, I mean, I really feel like the best matchup for them is going to be the averages. Or the averages.
Averages. Averages.
Averages, yeah, I think that was the...
It's the averages, because they're all... Well, they all are very modest and call themselves the average.
Okay.
Because like, they're in the sort of pro... No. Some of them rage. Apparently, Sparty's very, very calm, actually. I'm gauging... that top trumps thing I'm doing?
Yeah.
The Quakers, top rockets? Yep. Sparty's scoring very low on the rageometer.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, according to Demon. Demon's been playing with him quite a lot, and Sparty's always very very calm, apparently.
Awesome.
But and also the fact that they're all really strong players, but they're never sort of the superstars, essentially, in their own tier. They've all done extremely well, and they've won tournaments and things like that. And Noctis is an absolute legend, so I wouldn't really call him an averager at all. Noctis is a legend, and he can do a lot of damage, but...
Yeah, I think TDM-wise, that team has the best chance to take down... These guys, they know them the best, and
could
also
happen.
they're I think they can definitely.
If they take
win a
down iGamers, and if Meltdown continue to steamroll Deliberate Murder this way, then that could eventually be a final. But let's talk about some CTF, because that is coming up very soon. As I mentioned, there are some a lot of differences with TDM. The roles are far more clear cut. You usually have a defender. Depending on the map, you might have a mid player. You might have the attackers. You might have a high def, high mid, low mid, depending on the kind of map it is. And sometimes, if it was a map like Courtyard, which isn't in the pool, then you'd have sort of a high def, a defender, low defender. But the map pool for this is Pillbox, Ironworks, Spider Crossings, Japanese Castles, and Infinity. Not sure what maps have been picked just yet, but Infinity's had a lot of changes on it. They've moved the railgun to make it less accessible, medkits and stuff like that lying around. Be interesting to see if they pick that at all. Pillbox has been taken by the teams and welcomed openly by the teams. They really seem to be enjoying playing that at the moment. But Japanese Castles is definitely one of the maps you expect to see played the most.
Yeah, Spider, it's pretty classic.
Spider Crossings has three power-ups on it as well, so
yeah,
a lot for us to keep up with as if we get into some of these games.
It's good with Japanese castles these days because CTF used to be played with five players back in the days.
Mm-hmm.
It's been more commonly played with five players. There was one tournament actually which was a four player one. It's actually a Quakecon. I think it was like 2006 or something. It's like one Quakecon tournament I think which was four players. Maybe they're more, but it was a long time ago that they tried that, but then it was still more often like five players. But with a map like this with five players, that means usually you can have an extra player on defense or an extra player on offense, which actually, considering the map, makes it really hard to actually get flags out, because it's in a box.
Yeah.
Like the flag is in a box, and you've got to go up a really long staircase or through a jump pad or through this huge... like, it's very hard to get flags out. So actually, I like that for that map. Because always, with the five-player variant, I didn't really enjoy watching it as much.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm happy. Yeah. Happy with the maps.
Fair enough. Also, interestingly enough, because we're watching strictly European stuff this weekend, and CTF is really the North Americans that are the champions of that discipline. Yeah. I think the last time a European team was, it was a French team called AAA, and they won. Was it Quakecon 2004?
Oh my god! Was it that long ago?
Yeah, it was like a decade ago, basically.
So Linkin would have been on one of those lineups, I should think.
I think there was like Saint-Germain and the Fou. Some others. Yeah, I think Fou was there, and I can't remember the other players. But there was, a very long time ago, and the Europeans have been trying desperately to claim back this...
Vertex, maybe?
I'm not sure, but he's Belgian.
Yeah,
but
I think he was on the team, yeah.
Yeah, he's been around for
a
long time.
He was a very, very good CTF player.
Belgium is extremely good in Quake, actually. If you put a CTF team together for that, if you have Demon, Vertex... God, the first LAN I ever went to, Eindhoven LAN, the CTF LAN there, there was just Impulse, another player, and Demon will kill me for not remembering the others, but yeah, there's some insanely good Belgian players. It's a pity that people seem to be like scampering away at the moment, but long live Quake. Let's move into some CTF in a moment, as I think the map's starting to be picked. Producer Reese? Not yet. Okay. Apparently we have to take a break first. Before we get over to the CTF, because of this crazy system that we've got going on in the tournament today.
Nice.
So, guys, we'll see you in a moment as we move into the CTF part of this series.